Hey guys, it's Andre from High Performance Academy. Thanks for your patience there as we just worked through a couple of technical issues. And we're here with another one of our webinars. This time we're going to be diving into a wiring webinar. We're going to be talking about CAN termination resistors. We'll find out what they are and why we need those. And I'm going to show you the technique that I use to make up a terminating resistor. It's nice and easy and works out to be pretty reliable too. Before we get into that though, just wanted to cover off a few things that have been happening around here. And for those who have been watching for the last few weeks, you'll know that we are finalizing a few of the wiring harness design details on our FD RX7. And one of the problems that this has highlighted, which is pretty common when you are making up a custom wiring harness for just about any application, is how do you go about correctly mounting that to both the chassis as well as the engine? Now, obviously, when you're dealing with a factory wiring harness, this is all thought out by those OE engineers, and they'll generally have some nice little tabs with some little plastic grommets that go into them, and then a cable tie that kind of wraps around the harness, making sure it's all secure. Now, this is quite important because securing that harness properly makes sure that it's not going to end up rubbing against any of the components in the engine, and this is going to help make sure that we don't end up abrading through the sheathing on our harness. Again, just adding up to a harness that's going to be reliable over a long period of time. But of course, when we move to the aftermarket, we may not have the option of using these factory mounting techniques. So what can we do? Now, it's pretty typical to use the good old cable tie or zip tie and essentially cable tie our harness to anything that is routed beside in order to stop that relative movement. And there's nothing necessarily wrong with that, provided we're a little bit intelligent about our selection of where to mount the components. However, there are some situations where that may not be enough, and ultimately we may end up with a large section of our harness which is essentially unsupported. So a little technique that I just wanted to show you, a product that I just wanted to show you, is a little aluminium mounting tab. I'll just show you here and then we'll jump to our overhead screen and have a little more of a detailed look. So there's really not a lot to it. As you can see there, it is just a little flat aluminium plate, and as you can hopefully see, it's got a little loop of aluminium there which is designed for us to run a zip tie or cable tie through. Now, what we can do with these little plates, these little mounting plates, is we can glue them to our either our chassis or our engine using an adhesive. And it might sound a little bit weird, but this is actually a technique that we see used quite regularly in a professional level of motorsport. So if you've looked at any proper race cars, a mounting tab like this or a variation of a mounting tab like this is something you'll quite often see to properly secure the wiring harnesses well as other components. And I do have it on good authority that these little mounting tabs were actually used on the original McLaren F1 in order to secure the wiring harness to the rocker covers. Now, personally, I haven't been lucky enough to get that up close and personal with the McLaren F1, so I can only take this as third-hand information. I recommend you probably fact check that, but the fact remains that for us, this is a perfectly good option. Now, the next question with these mounting tabs is, how are we going to actually secure them to our engine and or our components that we're going to want to glue them to? And there are a variety of epoxies that probably would do the job. The one that I have been recommended, it was quite specific that we use a Loctite product, and it's a Loctite 330 product. Now, actually, what we'll do is we'll just jump across to my laptop screen. And this is the little guy here that I tried to order. So we can see it's actually two-part. We've got the yellow product and then the green bottle is an activator. So it's a two-part product there. So that's what I tried to order. Turns out in New Zealand, great, my laptop's frozen. Let me just see if we can deal with this. Bear with us for a second. All right, so we should have a laptop screen now. It's going to make it a little bit easier to show you what I was looking at there. So this is the Loctite 330 product, which I had tried to order. And it turns out that in New Zealand, this isn't a product that's been stocked that often, at least through the mainstream supplier that I went through. So that's what I ordered. And instead, what I actually ended up getting was this, which, I mean, there's no scale on that photo, but this isn't quite what I was after. Suffice to say that this is probably going to last me for about the next 100 years. As you could probably imagine, it doesn't take a lot of this Loctite product in order to stick those tabs down. However, long story short, this is a great option if you are looking at custom mounting a wiring harness and making sure that it's not going to move around. Nice subtle way of doing so, doesn't take up a lot of room, and the added bonus there as well is that you don't need to drill holes into either your chassis or your engine components in order to mount those little tabs. Right, last week I was talking about the drive-by-wire throttle conversion, or the potential for a drive-by-wire throttle conversion in our FD RX7. We've got a little bit of progress on that front here, and what I've done is I've actually grabbed the upper inlet manifold off that car so that we can have a better look at what's actually involved here. So what I'll do is I'll separate it, and for a start, let's just have a look at the upper inlet manifold itself, because for those of you who aren't sort of familiar with rotary engines, these are a little bit unique. So we've got the primary and the secondary inlet runners, and they're separated through the inlet manifold. And as an added little complexity, this is the double throttle system that we see in the FD RX7. So this is kind of designed as a bit of a safeguard by Mazda, and essentially it's controlled relative to engine coolant temperature. So when the engine is stone cold, these are in the closed position. You can see that they don't completely close. There's still going to be some airflow, but it acts as a way of throttling the airflow and basically limiting how hard you can push the engine when it's cold. Now, for our purposes, we're going to actually remove these, as it has been proven to be a minor flow restriction. But the complexity remains that we've got our primary and our secondary inlet runners, and as you can see there, that doesn't really mate up that nicely to a conventional single throttle body. So I've talked about all of that, just a graphic representation of that is a little bit easier, and we've got our throttle body here. Obviously we've got the different throttle plates, and what may be a little bit hard to notice here, let's go to our overhead and we'll see if this is obvious there. As I turn the bell crank here, what we can see is that the primary down the bottom, that throttle butterfly is starting to open. A little bit hard to see, and it takes a little bit of movement before we actually get to a point where the secondaries begin to open. So that's designed by Mazda. My understanding is to promote smooth drivability off idle, and we wanted to retain that, which is one of the reasons why I don't really want to go to a single throttle body. Maybe we could adapt up something like a GM LS2 drive-by-wire throttle body. Didn't really specifically want to do that. So what we've got, and this is what I talked about last week, is a drive-by-wire throttle actuator. This is off a S54 BMW M3 engine. So it's remote mounted, and we can then actuate the throttle body from a bell crank. Now, that also works in conjunction, of course, with a drive-by-wire throttle pedal. So there is a little bit involved with performing a drive-by-wire throttle conversion on a cable throttle car, notwithstanding the fact that we need an ECU in the first place that's capable of doing that. And obviously, we want to make sure that our drive-by-wire throttle pedal is securely mounted up on the firewall as well. And we want to make sure that we've matched the throw of the pedal so that we're not trying to overextend that pedal. It needs essentially a positive stop underneath it. So yeah, a little bit to think about there. We're still not 100% sold on what direction we're going to go with this, because again, if you've been watching, you may recall that my intention was to actually mount our IGN1A coils underneath the inlet manifold, and that would probably be the natural position for us to also mount our BMW throttle body actuator. So that's going to probably want to mount somewhere under there on top of the block. Obviously we're not going to have room for everything, so something might have to give. At the moment, it's possible and probable even that just to get some progress with this project and get it up and running, we are probably going to start with it just running a cable throttle body. Nothing necessarily wrong with that. We will maybe revisit the drive-by-wire throttle conversion a little bit further down the track. All right, I just wanted to give you a bit of an update as well, and this leads nicely into the YouTube video that I'm going to show you that we've released today. For those who, again, have been watching fastidiously over the last few months, you'll know that we did go through what we've referred to affectionately as our ghetto engine rebuild on our white Toyota 86 development car. So that's the car that bent one of the factory conrods just prior to one of our live webinars. Always a slightly awkward situation, but also a bit of a risk with what we're doing. So we've rebuilt that engine with a set of aftermarket rods, and the video that I'll show you in a second, we've sort of covered that build up in a lot more detail. However, that car also still hasn't actually been going officially. We got it all back together and we actually struck a bit of a problem with it in that at the same time the engine was being rebuilt, we also sent the car away to have a roll cage installed in it, just adding a little bit more safety for that particular car. And of course, as part of this, as anyone out there who has had a cage installed in a car before would know, you basically need to pull most of the interior apart. So we got the engine back in, the cage was in, and it was a case of starting to piece all of the factory electronics and wiring harness back together. And when we went to get it up and running, we found that we're in a situation where the immobilizer seemed to be giving us grief. The remote key lock wouldn't operate, wouldn't lock and unlock the doors, and we couldn't get the engine to actually crank. There were a few other issues with what was and wasn't powering up, but basically all a pretty weird situation. Not something that we couldn't get on top of, but we also were incredibly busy with our production schedule at that time, so it unfortunately had to get parked. We've just recently employed a new staff member, Brandon, all the way from Ireland. He is a pretty accomplished mechanic and auto electrician, and we stuck him on the car, and within about the first 8 hours of working here, he had managed to get to the bottom of the problem, which was, interestingly enough, one of the factory connectors for the body harness. So I'll jump across to my laptop screen. It is a little bit hard to get context of this photo, but what we've got here is one of the factory body connectors. This is at the base of the front left door. So the piece of cage that we've got here is actually the A-pillar coming down from the windscreen. And there are two of these connectors that end up around about this location in the car. And in an interesting twist, which is quite unlike Toyota in my experience so far, they actually are the same pinout or the same connector. So what this means is it's possible to plug them in around the wrong way. Murphy's Law, exactly, that is what we did. So Brandon has got that car up and running, and we are a little bit further through progress on that car. In particular, we've got the interior back together, as we can see here. I've just gone through putting a removable steering boss on this car as well, which in order to keep the factory clock spring, which is necessary because it has the steering angle sensor built into it, it's actually a little bit harder than we're given credit for to get a boss kit that suited that and our existing removable steering wheels. The reason for this is we are going to be running some of our buttons for our dash controls, as well as things such as pit limiters up onto the steering wheel. We'll be covering that as we go through it. Now, we have left the interior in this car, as you can see, or at least the carpet. We're leaving as much of the interior in as we can, and the reason for this is we are going to be using this car for an upcoming project. So this is the exterior of the car at the moment. We've got it stripped down because tomorrow it is getting wrapped, and I just wanted to sort of talk about a new project that we have got coming out. So this is the wrap that's going on the car. Some of you may already have heard a little bit about this project. We have been working on it for about the last 18 months, 2 years. Started off as a very basic idea to basically do what we're doing now for High Performance Academy, but move into the driver education as well as race car development workspace. And we know that just like our tuning, wiring and engine building industry, this is an area where there is a lot of misinformation. There is a need for solid information there, and we're really excited to bring RaceCraft out. It's probably still a few months away, but our Toyota 86 is going to be one of our development and test cars for RaceCraft, and that's the wrap that's going to be going on it. So just to give you an idea of what's going to come out in RaceCraft, the format is going to be exactly the same as how High Performance Academy works right now. We're going to be running our video-based training courses, and we're going to be backing that up with forum support on our website, and we'll also be running similar live webinars to what you're watching right now. In the initial stages, I'm going to be fronting a couple of the lessons, the courses. However, we are looking to get other staff on board. My knowledge in the race car development scene is definitely not unlimited, but we're sort of also aware that we aren't professionals in that area, particularly in driver education. So we want to get some pros on board that can really push into that area and give the high quality level of education that we are well known for. And we're going to be launching initially with a course that I'm just in the middle of finishing off right now. And I know this is going to be really beneficial to those who are maybe weekend warriors, taking your factory road car along to track days on weekends, or even those who are sort of a little bit more committed. They've got a car that's a dedicated race car that they are running on weekends or in race series as an amateur or semi-professional. So the course that we are developing at the moment is Motorsport Wheel Alignment Fundamentals, and along with this, it's going to teach you essentially how to do quality string wheel alignments with a relatively minor investment in equipment, making sure that you can make adjustments both in your home workshop as well as at the track to suit the track conditions. So really excited about that project, and we'll be bringing you more information about that as it comes to hand. Now, I did mention our video just before, which we'll head across to my laptop screen again, and this is our Toyota 86 Ghetto FA20 build. So basically covers exactly what we're doing and why. It's a quick rundown on the build. You'll get to watch a time lapse of that build being completed, and basically just some information around some of the key questions that we always get about basic engine building, such as how do we make adjustments to our bearing clearances if those are required, why would we change certain components inside of the engine, and also the question that's always coming up, how do I correctly run in or bed in a freshly built engine. So all of that information and more in there. Make sure you head across to our YouTube channel, check that video out, and subscribe. If you do have any questions, please leave those in the comments and I'll be happy to jump in there and answer them. Right, we have been running our Wiseco Piston giveaway, and happy to announce that the winner has just been announced for that giveaway, which is Eric Jaworski, I think it is. I'm sorry if I've mucked up your surname there, Eric, and he's all the way from Canada, so he'll be getting himself a set of Wiseco's shelf stock pistons to suit anything that they currently do. We have got another one of our giveaways that has literally just gone live, and this is for the ECU Master EMU Black ECU. So perfect for any of you out there who are considering an ECU upgrade for a project car. This is a really powerful and fully featured ECU despite its tiny size. It's so small that last time we gave one of these away last year, this exact one actually, I managed to drop it right here in a live webinar. And so we've inherited this because dropping it also managed to crack the connector. That's my bad. Probably not really a downside of the ECU itself. Probably don't really want to be dropping any aftermarket ECU. But this little guy will control up to 6 injectors or 6 ignition outputs direct. It also actually has the ability to run up to a 12-cylinder engine. An interesting aspect with the EMU Black is it has a built-in igniter module, so you can run smart coils or passive coils directly off the EMU Black. You don't need an external igniter module. Has the ability to run a single drive-by-wire throttle body. Also has built-in wideband, which is quite unusual, I've found, in the majority of the entry-level and even moderately advanced ECUs these days. Still, not a lot of ECUs are providing that on board, so it cuts down on the expense of needing an external CAN-based wideband controller or external analog voltage-based wideband controller. So if you want to get your name into the draw, I'll get the team to drop a link into the comments that you can follow, and of course, along with that EMU Black, you're also going to be getting access to our complete suite of tuning courses so that you're going to know exactly what to do with it. That includes our EFI Tuning Fundamentals course, our practical standalone tuning course, understanding air fuel ratio, and access to our private members only community, so you can watch webinars like this as well as get involved in our private members only forum. All right, so follow that link. There are also a few other instructions that you can go through to get yourself a few more entries into that draw. So give yourself the best chance possible. And of course, there is absolutely no catch here, no cost to get involved in that giveaway. All right, team, thanks for watching. Give me a few moments and we'll get started with today's webinar.